Okay, can you go and check now? Yeah, I'll send you a link.
Nah. The vegan Nazi.
Oh, it's working this thing.
It's happening.
Yeah. Beautiful. Beautiful. Let's get Grant on this. Let's get Grant. One viewer, brilliant. That's better than zero.
Maybe. What are you gonna say now?
To be honest, like there've been times where it's been 20 viewers. I'm thinking, you're not a mum for me. It's such long.
Sophie's viewing it, so it's maybe Doug or someone's watching it. Yeah, it's a shame.
I don't care.
Hey, Grant. Sorry.
Hey, Ronnie. No problem.
Right, it's definitely going live now.
Okay. So where do we go from here?
Good question. Well, we've had a good chat so far. How about we just
We've had a good warm up.
Yeah. How about we talk about some of the events that you run for a start? So you help out with a lot of different events. How about you speak about some of those?
Sure. So for the last, since 2007, that's when I ran my first retreat ever. It was held in Australia, and you know, some prominent figures came, like Dorian Ryder and Freely, good friends of mine.
Oh wow!
So there was all a lot of history there, and it was a great event, and it went on to me hosting events every year since. So for the last, since 2011, I've been hosting an annual event in Thailand, which has become known as the Thailand Adventure Retreat or the Thailand Fruit and Adventure Retreat. Mm-hmm. And it's an 80-10-10 friendly event where we spend 2 weeks in Thailand, in Chantaburi, which is where a quarter of the world's durian is grown, just in that one province. Thailand grows half of the world's durian, and half of that is grown just in the province of Chantaburi.
Oh, wow.
So it's durian central. We're there in peak durian season. Durian's one reason why people come, but that's... certainly not the main focus, although it is for many of us. I take people to where there's 200-year-old durian trees and original varieties that are only in that local area. And there are certainly fruits that are very unique to that area and you would never get anywhere else. So a lot of fruit experiences, we go to fruit farms, we go to organic, not all organic, but as much as possible and practical, we go to... we get organic food and go to organic farms. We can climb fruit trees like mangosteen trees and have a great time like that. We go on outings every day. There's to waterfalls and beaches with monkeys, like not just waterfalls, but like nine tiers of waterfall all in the one area. It's like some of the most beautiful places I've seen in the world. We go to private property that through connections that I've got. So you get an experience that you can't get just coming as a tourist.
Great.
So I have a great close friend in the area who is a tour guide that obviously speaks fluent Thai, as he was born and bred in Chantaburi, and he's done fruit farming and all sorts of stuff. So, and he went vegan as a result of hanging out with our group, and eats mostly raw now. So. It's pretty cool. So we're really close and close friends, and he's our tour guide for the retreat. We get unlimited fruit. We have daily group discussions about meaningful topics, not just about food, but about life and the universe and everything, and really customize that to whoever's at the event. Talk about you know, some years there's more beginners, and other years there's more like expertise, like people that have been doing 80-10-10 for years, and they're just coming to hang out and eat fruit and you know, chill out with friends and have a good time. Other people are coming there to learn how to change their life, overcome health issues.
Yeah.
Some people bring their children. Some, you know, there's been people there of all ages, from like babies up to like 70 years old, even 80 years old at my Australian retreats. We get Thai massage, we get a herbal wood fire sauna, lots of authentic experiences interacting with local culture. It's just an amazing time. To me, it's up there with the best retreats in the world, for what you get out of it. And it changes people's lives. The feedback I get is always positive. People do well when they're in a supportive environment.
Sure.
And then I run an event in Thailand. The Thailand Adventure Retreat is in May each year, and I'm running two of those each year back to back. So for the whole month of May, I run that event. And then in December, I run an event with Ted Carr called Thai Fruit Camp, which is for runners. And it's a running camp held at an Olympic facility in Chiang Mai, Thailand. And we just coach people on improving their running.
Yep.
We do video analysis and just everything running. And it's a raw vegan fruit-based event as well. So, and we have daily discussions and talks about lifestyle as well as about running, but it's all focused around how to improve your running, and your diet and lifestyle is a key factor in recovery and performance and all that sort of stuff. So yeah, that's another great event. They're my two, and then the Baosheng Durian Festival, of course, which I've been running. This will be the third year of the Baosheng Durian Festival.
Yep.
So with Lindsay Gassick from yearofthedurian.com, and I put that on, and it's just a week of premium, like absolute world class durian from, you know, old trees. Old trees taste better. The fruit tastes better from old trees. So it's organic, it's freshly dropped, it's incredible varieties that you would never find in a lot of places, like they're difficult to find. And yeah, it's an unbelievable fruit-based experience. But we also have adventures there. We go on day trips and hikes, you know, go up mountains and to beaches and have presentations. So there's an education aspect there as well.
So we really, lots of, yeah. So you really spend almost all of your year at different retreats and events, or a lot of your year anyway, at raw vegan events.
Yeah, absolutely. Anywhere from 5 to 10 months of the year is what it's been in recent years that I spend. I've actually overseas at events or preparing for an event,
and previously
cleaning up after an event.
But this has been a big change, and I wondered if the change in diet kind of affected the change in your lifestyle as well, your career and everything else, or had you finished with your previous career before you moved towards this?
Yeah, no, this lifestyle was definitely a catalyst for me taking action on issues that where my life wasn't in alignment with where I really ideally wanted it to be, but there are things that I could have tolerated for the rest of my life, which I think unfortunately most people kind of do fall into that convenience and just doing what they're used to and just feeling like because I was an IT specialist at IBM, so computer programming, team leading on big projects for government, for banks, for huge sporting events like the Grand Slam tennis events I was working on big projects, like all those sort of things.
Yeah.
And that was great and challenging, and that did my mind good, but it wasn't fulfilling. I didn't feel like I was creating value. I didn't believe that I was creating value just by helping banks to do to be more efficient at taking money off people and to help insurance companies from, you know, propagate their own cause again to make money from people. it's not a goodwill thing. They're not in business for goodwill. They're in business to make money. And I just didn't believe in the whole everything kind of behind basically contributing to building cities into bigger cities and more streamlined and efficient cities, more streamlined and efficient at taking money off people and taking away their lives, trading it for just to do work for others. So I got out of the corporate world, but it was definitely the catalyst was definitely that I had improved my life in a number of ways. First by going vegetarian and then 18 months vegan and then 6.5 years later raw vegan, because that was all still while I was at IBM. And I lasted at IBM for a bit over 2 years after I, 2.5 years after I went raw vegan. But during the last 2 years, I would say that I was at IBM, I was looking for a way out. I was actively kind of in my mind. I was like, this something has, I knew something had to change. But at first I had no clue how to do that because, I was an IT specialist. That's how I was trained. I did computer science for 3 years at university and, and I ended up being at IBM for 15 years. So it took 13 years before I was looking to make change. And I came across the concept of lifestyle coach. And when I saw that, which was a career choice I wasn't previously aware of, I didn't know it existed. that was when I joined Doug Graham's lifestyle coaching program and went on to finish that, all three levels of that program. So I was actually the only person that went through all three levels of that program, but a lot of people went through level one of the program. And that was, you know, where I learned a lot of what I know, because I just once I'd been doing 80-10-10 for a couple of years before I joined that coaching program, you know, I knew how to eat, I knew what I wanted in life. Things started becoming clearer, and I sought out Doug Graham because, you know, he was the best in the world and he was the only person in the world that could teach me what I wanted to learn. I didn't want to learn just for the sake of learning. I didn't want to just get a certificate that said that I knew something. I want to actually really know, live and breathe the, you know, about lifestyle. And I got that from Doug Graham for sure. You know, he really, like, obviously I did a lot of it myself, learning a lot of things, like, you got to pay attention. But he really was the most significant influence and greatest source of information and ideas for how to grow. He recommended that I do Toastmasters, for example, which I know you've also done, Ronnie. Absolutely, which is a public speaking, which is a fantastic public speaking organization that's worldwide. Almost every town in the world has a Toastmasters organization set up, and you can just go along. It's super cheap, and you just learn how to speak in a very safe environment. In the same way that the UK Fruit Festival is like a perfect, an idyllic environment to improve your lifestyle. So immersing yourself in that environment is a very intelligent thing to do, in my opinion. Same for Toastmasters. If you want to improve your self-confidence not just public speaking, but just speaking skills, which even comes down to just communicating with friends and family and work colleagues. All of those things improve tremendously through the feedback and experience that you get through Toastmasters. And Doug Graham recommended that I go through that program. So, you know, he wasn't just looking to teach me what he knows, but he was looking to help me to grow which I really valued and still got, you know, still appreciate and value that he did that. So yeah, that was kind of a lot of my life went into that. But the catalyst definitely going raw vegan. I mean, going vegan was a huge thing for me back in 1999, because I was started making ethical choices where I would choose to abstain from some food or practice or purchase that, because I knew that it had a negative effect on others, specifically animals, typically.
Sure.
But sometimes the environment, sometimes other humans, like cheap labor or something like that. but when I went raw vegan, it was so much more profound, because a large reason behind going raw vegan was that it was for me. It was for my health. It was for my well-being. It was for my, and for a short time, you know, like the first day or so, I really struggled with that. Because I was like, I had the information, I'd heard the Perfect Health Program, and I wanted to go raw vegan, but I just remember a number of hours where I was just having these struggles in my head, like, but am I worth it? And the answer came back, well, no, why would I do that? Why would I give up these delicious foods, all these cooked vegan, amazing treat, you know, foods that I've been eating for the last 6.5 years, why would I give them up to go raw for no reason other than myself? Okay. And my health and my sense of well-being. But you know, it was just literally just after a short amount of time of thinking about that I came to the conclusion was like, well, duh, of course I'm worth it. And that was probably one of the first great acts of self-love that I'd done for myself in my life. So that was a really profound time where I chose to do something for me. And prior to that, you know, I usually sacrificed myself and did things for other people, and you know, and felt good about it, but I wasn't meeting my own needs, and that wasn't, you know, sustainable. And there was no need to, you know, to sacrifice myself. There was some mixed up logic, like the drive behind it wasn't coming from a good place. It was coming from a place of emotional neglect, or you know, just like personal issues that were within me that I was propagating from you know, everything in my life that had led to that point. So I sort of overcame these issues of kind of shyness and lack of self-confidence and lack of self-love and like a lack of integrity is what it would kind of comes out at the end of the day. It all comes out, it came out as like knots in my stomach and all these things that I was doing that weren't congruent with my true values. So I made all these changes and spent a lot of time at raw food festivals and events. I've been at every food and sport event with Doug Graham since 2008, since late 2007, when he came to Australia. And, you know, I did a water fast with Doug Graham as well for 29 days of nothing but water. And that also was a big catalyst in personal growth and knowing and understanding myself, because that was the first time in my life that I'd allowed myself to do nothing as an activity rather than having an agenda to, you know, to kind of become some great academic, rich, famous, popular, whatever, you know, someone of status in the, so you get paid more money and then have more things and more stuff. you know, it's kind of driven by the same things that a lot of other people in society are driven by back then, because I didn't have any other direction given to me by any other, by role models in life, really. So I had to figure all that out kind of by finding new role models and just doing it. So yeah, the water fast definitely helped me to know myself and to, I don't say to become a better person. I say to become, to become a better version of me, because I feel like I'm always who I have been. But for many years, I was, you know, like kind of, I use the analogy that I was like wrapped in cobwebs, that I wasn't, you know, I was like, I was living in the shadows, just kind of observing the world and watching it go by, but not really fully engaged, not really bringing myself, you know, every and all the great things that I have to offer to the world. So, because I was scared to, and I didn't know how to, and I was, so that would come out as awkwardness, and you know, awkwardness doesn't make friends, and awkwardness doesn't have confidence. So you lose out, you miss out on a lot of opportunities in life without confidence. So yeah, the lifestyle improvements of diet, and the water fasting, which also gave me new benchmarks for sleep as well, the value of sleep, because prior to that, I'd never really experienced what it was to be super well rested. But sleeping up to 17 hours a day during my water fast, it was unbelievable. So, and you know, I'll never forget what that. And it's not possible to live normal life, eating food and doing daily activity to be that well rested. It's just not, it's not possible. But
sounds good.
But I have that benchmark, and so I know what well rested is. And I know that working on my book for the last year has not left me well rested. but I look forward to getting a lot of rest now that I've just published it last night.
Yeah, tell us about the book.
So the book is a series called Inspired to Run.
It's up on Amazon now.
The first book is on Amazon right now. I wanted to make it free, but they wouldn't let me make it free because I'm a new author, I guess, or because I think once I add other versions of the book, like paperback or Audible, maybe I can make it free then. I don't know. But just that first theme of the book. It's a book series that's got 9 volumes. So the first one is called Success Stories. So it's called Inspired to Run, Volume 1, Success Stories. And it profiles some great. Ronnie's going to be the first person to give a review. I can tell it.
I just went over now to buy it. Yeah.
That's fantastic, Ronnie. I can watch you and I can see you on the little screen there.
I was just looking.
You look like you shop. You look like you're shopping. You're very happy.
It's an shopping impulse purchase. Good. Yeah.
Yeah. But you could well be the first person to buy it, Ronnie, because I only put it up like just a matter of like hours ago. So it's $1.98 Australian, I think. So that was the cheapest price it would put it up for. And that's the Kindle version. But it will be available in Audible book. I am going to read it myself, and I hope to have that up within the next 2 weeks. And now that I've got the actual book published, I know what the content is, so I can make the Audible book.
Fantastic.
And I will do print on demand as well as soon as I get on and figure out the process for that, which is interesting because now Kindle's direct publishing program by Amazon now also offers print on demand in addition to CreateSpace.
So yeah, you just need to use one of them. You don't need to use both.
That's right.
All you need to do is get the format. You just need to get the cover formatted and the inside formatted for paperback, and then upload it, and then they'll check it.
Right, which I've already done. Unless they force you to remove all links, but I've put all. Like Wikipedia style links in, so that they're not just hyperlinks, which obviously don't work in a printed book.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, it is. I think it's basically ready to be printed. So it shouldn't be much work. I hope to get the paperback out. So hopefully that'll be, you know, up in less than a week to be able to get a print on demand version. And the other 8 books in the series, I've written, you know. Most of the content, there's just a couple of bits of content that I've got to update in a couple of the books, but you know, so it's 95% complete kind of thing. So those other books should follow fairly quickly. You get all those up before, you know, in the next month or so, as soon as I'm able, just put them.
Can I ask, Grant, did you try and set the price to zero?
I did, yeah.
Okay. Well, I think there is a way of doing that, but what you can do is do a free, if you go into your thing, you'll be able to set a free promotion.
So right, they have five time period.
I'll go and check. I think I saw there's a way of setting it permanently free, but I'll check and see if I can find the information for you.
But, great. Yep. I mean, I'll check that out for sure.
One second. Yep. Purchased.
Well, thank you very much, Ronnie. Appreciate the support.
Yeah. And yeah, I'll give you a review, extensive review on everything that I come up with when I've read it.
Fantastic.
Well,
but there's still no reviews. Cool. You still have the chance to be the first.
Oh, absolutely. Amazon is telling me that, like, you can be the first to review this item.
Okay, nice.
It looks great. Oh, I like the cover.
Oh, thanks. Yeah, I designed the cover myself. So.
Oh, did you?
At first, I didn't put myself on it, but I was talked into it, and I do think it was a good decision to put myself on the cover. But I was a bit humble about that at first. I had a silhouette at first of a runner.
That's nice.
Yeah. It's one of my friends made a funny comment. Michael Charland made a really funny comment about the cover. He said, "So am I taking up sky running? Because I'm kind of up in the up, running off the sunset." And
yeah.
And I said, "No, it's just the runner's high."
Very good. Yeah, so I'm gonna read. Let me read some of the blurb on it. From an experienced ultramarathon runner who insightfully shares incredible stories and inspiring quotes of legendary runners and their coaches in all disciplines from the sprint to the marathon. Not since Dr. Kenneth Cooper inspired an entire nation to get out and run with his book Aerobics has anything been written that provides such a powerful inducement to get moving as Inspired to Run. Grant Campbell loves to run, and as much as running, he equally loves to talk about running and about runners. With more than five dozen ultramarathons to his credit, Grant has more than proven his interest in the time-honoured sport of running. His running clinics change lives, and how Inspired to Run will change countless more lives, converting non-runners into runners, motivating, committing runners to be their best. The stories in Inspired to Run are about committed people doing exceptional things. Every story is uplifting, every performance spectacular. Each runner set a new standard. Sit back, read, appreciate the stories. And give you fresh enthusiasm and enjoy running more than ever. That's from Doug Graham. That's a really nice little endorsement there.
Yeah, I was I was very delighted when he sent me that. I was it's just amazing that he spent that much time to put something together like that. very received in a very heartfelt way. So yeah,
it's brilliant. That's great. Fantastic. Yeah, so everyone should go and download that and get some reviews up for Grant.
Yeah, definitely. Definitely. Reviews are very important. So I need reviews for sure at the moment. And I will try after this call. I'll see if I can just see if it's an easy matter of just switching it over to make it free.
The thing that I was talking to you about the other night, that's something that I've done with some of the books I've put up, was do the 5-day free thing, but have scheduled so that you contact people then and get them to download it for free then or whatever. But supposedly paid reviews are better than free reviews, so
you know, there's balance there. But there's only a couple of questions I wanted to ask you. I don't want to take up too much of your time, because I know you were only meant to be here till 10 minutes ago.
It's fine. Whatever works. I don't have the urgency to leave like I did before. We changed our plans, so now we start later. So it's okay.
Okay. The two questions that came up earlier on. One was about fruit quality. We were discussing that with Anne, and also chemicals on fruit, which I don't think we got to. These are two things that people bring up kind of a lot. How much are you concerned about the quality of the fruit you're getting, and also the chemicals on the fruit and modern farming methods and stuff like that?
Yeah, I mean, quality of fruit is huge. It's part of the reason why people travel across the world to go to events like the Baosheng Durian Festival to get the world's best, because once you've experienced how good fruit can be, fresh from the tree, from old trees, from organic, you know, really well-loved trees, it's unbelievable the difference in quality. But as far as, you know, not everyone lives in parts of the world like that where that quality of fruit is available. And like in Australia, that's when I eat the worst quality food that I would eat through the year, I would say, in the area where I live. Because I don't live up north. I don't live in the tropical area. I live 100 kilometres, 60 miles from Sydney. And, you know, there's some super tasty fruit, but it's conventional, and you know it's been sprayed. And so there's certain foods where I don't eat the skin, you know, like I'll peel cucumbers and peel zucchinis or courgettes, for example. But, you know, but there's certainly fruits where I eat the skin of it, like peaches, where I know they're sprayed. But so to me, you know, there's always that point between what's more important to you. Is freshness more important, or is organic more important? And to me, I would rather have good tasting fruit that's not organic than to have unripe, poor tasting organic food.
Mm-hmm.
Because not all organic food is good. Because a lot of people growing organic food don't eat the food. Don't really care about the food other than to make money. They probably inherited the farm from their parents, and it's just a business to a lot of them. So, and after decades of running a business like that, they you know, they're not so passionate about the quality. They just do whatever it takes to make sure people will keep buying the food.
Do you find that people seem to worry about the quality of fruit and the chemicals in fruit in a way that is disproportionate to how much they worry about how much nutrients is in their rice, bread, pasta, dead animals,
right,
milk, whatever.
Yeah.
Whatever else.
I mean, for sure, you know, you don't have to look far to see people that are neurotic about nutrition, what they call nutrition. But I think it's, you know, it's probably more malnourishing to worry about all these micronutrients and go to the, you know, go to the doctors and get tested every week, get your blood tests and or even don't do that and just worry all the time because you don't know what your levels are, but you're very concerned about it. You know, I feel like you probably waste more, for example, B vitamins, which are kind of used up more when you're stressed. A lot of people probably spend more B vitamins worrying about B12 than you know than doing things to conserve it. There are definitely, there's so much mixed information. It's a problem with being in this age where we have so much information. There's a lot of incredible benefits of having access to so much information, but you also have access to more incongruent information and bad information, misleading and deceptive information, where people are just trying to sell you products, latest packaged products. So I avoid all packaged products, which helps keep me a bit out of that circle. But the focus on I think conventional food isn't always worse than organic food. Like organic practices can also use chemicals. Organic practices can also be terrible for the environment. You know, you can have organic fish meal and organic blood and bone to put on your soil, for example, that are really unethical practices and destroying the environment. You know, I get grapes sometimes that have the taste of choline, which is that fishy smell.
Oh yeah.
And I don't know where it comes from, and it makes me uncomfortable every time because I'm eating grapes and I'm smelling fish and I'm like, what is it? Is it because they put fish products on the soil?
Right.
I mean, is it really that much that it's actually on? You can taste it on the fruit, or is it waxed or coated in something to protect it from insects? I don't know. They do a lot of weird things to get fruit to the market intact.
Sure.
And you know that they're not ideal, and my philosophy is I just get the best quality that I can. You can't do better than that. There's no point, you know, I can't live on nothing. So I've got to eat. So I can miss meals for a few days, no problem, but it's not my preference. So I just choose the best quality I can. And price is a consideration for me. I'm not rolling in money. I'm not Mr. Corporate World high roller anymore, earning, you know, $150,000 a year from IBM. So, you know, I don't earn much money anymore. So, but I earn enough money to have a beautiful life, and not because I live very simply and frugally. And so price for me is a factor as well when I'm choosing food.
Right.
So that's another quality of my food, is, well, how much is it? Because I can't pay, you know, the price of durian in Australia, for example, on the money that I earn. So yeah, for me it's a trade-off, and I make the best decision I can. So I'm always getting, like, you know, I have enough experience with fruit that I can tell whether it's going to taste good or not, generally by looking at it. Not always, but generally I can. So, you know, there's certain varieties. Like I've been getting these cantaloupes at the moment, rock melons. There's two varieties that they're alternating each week. One of them is one of them tastes delicious, and it's called something like Doltrune or something like that. And then the other variety is called Sucro, and the Sucro ones are terrible, and the other ones are awesome. So, you know, like, I'm grateful that I buy by the box, so I can actually see what the variety is, because when I ask in the store, they wouldn't have a clue. And so I might use sometimes I buy, you know, based on whether the what variety it is. So there's a lot to learn about knowing when certain quality of fruits are available at certain time of the year. So sometimes, you know, when fruits are out of season, you can get new season oranges that look amazing, but they're sour, extremely sour. And so it's not a good time to buy them. They're going to be overpriced and the quality is going to be terrible, even though they look good. And yeah, but if you're buying things in peak season, they'll be the cheapest. They'll be easy to find. They'll be everywhere, and they'll taste the best. So that's when I buy what's in peak season wherever I am, and I don't get caught up in the, oh gee, I haven't had this in avocado for a while. I'm really drawn to pay $4 for an avocado, and it's terrible quality because they've had awful growing practices in order to get it available out of season. And there might be, extra, might have strings through it, or bruising, or the stones under the skin, or whatever it is. Or it might just have a really bad texture or flavor at all. So I try to buy the best tasting. If organic is available, it's my preference for sure. As long as it's at a reasonable price that I can afford. I used to buy organic a lot when I used to go to the Sydney wholesale markets, because I was getting wholesale prices, and also buying in bulk. So you get big discounts. And I would also often buy seconds or you know, the second rate or overripe quality fruit that they call
stuff,
overripe. The stuff the shops won't buy because, you know, a retailer to buy fruit from a wholesale market, they're going to have it on their shelves for a while. So if they're buying it ripe, it's going to go bad before they can sell it all. So they want to buy unripe fruit, have it ripen on their shelves, or in the homes of the people that buy the fruit from them. Yeah. Or unfortunately, a lot of people actually just eat unripe fruit because they don't know any better.
That's it.
So yeah, quality to me, it's, a lot of it's about taste. Price is a factor. And whether it's sprayed or not, whether it's organic certified or not, is important to me. But I don't always know. You know, a lot of stuff in the market is organic just because they didn't use any sprays, but they don't want to spend tens of thousands of dollars to get it certified as organic. For example, in Thailand, you know, no Thai farmers aren't going out certifying themselves as organic. But there's plenty out there that are saying that they're organic. And some places just spray when a plant is a seedling to protect it during those early growth stages, but they don't spray when the tree is fruiting for a period before it fruits, from before the flowers come until until the fruit is off the tree. So that's, you know, it's better than having the actual fruit sprayed itself. It's, you know, we live in the world that we live in, and part of being happy and healthy is acceptance of what is. You know, obviously with an intent to influence and improve the conditions of the world, but there's no point being in denial of what is. What is. And when I go to the fruit shop today, whatever's available is what I have to choose from. And so I just choose the best quality that I can afford. And leave it at that, and I'm happy, and I don't beat myself up. Oh no, I've eaten some conventional food, because it's just not worth it. Because I made the best choice I could. So, if you make the best choices you can, you have a clear conscience, and you'll build integrity with everything that you do, and you'll be happy and healthy, and it's a good way to live.
Fantastic. Well, just to let everyone know, Grant will be at the UK Fruit Festival, which is one of the reasons that we're speaking today. And we have our launch day that finishes in a couple of hours, our time. So the festival has a launch day discount price, which you can check out at fruitfest.co.uk. And click on the button for registration to find out more information about the event, to register. And you're going to secure the best price today, and there's no risk if you decide that you don't want to come in a few weeks' time or a few months. You can simply get a refund of that, but you can pay it up as well if you don't want to pay it all out in one go. So there's a number of different options. There's camping option, there is cabins, there's chalets, different accommodation off-site if you want to stay somewhere else. So a lot of flexibility there. But today is our launch day and our registration day, and we really, really hope to see you there, and we're going to do our best to make it absolutely glorious for you. So anything you want to add to that, Grant, of your experience of the event, would you encourage people to go if they're in the mixed mind about it?
In a heartbeat. If you're thinking about it at all, you should be there. I mean, Ronnie really has put on a world-class event year after year. It really delivers on all of his promises. I don't say that things like that lightly. It's a phenomenal event, and you can see that when you get there, you'll know. You'll see the atmosphere. You'll feel the atmosphere. You'll see the look on people's faces. Everyone is so happy and so, they know they're in the right place, they're doing the right thing, and they're doing great things for themselves, and the sense of community there, to be amongst that many like-minded people who care about the choices they're making for themselves and for the environment and for all reasons, it's so beautiful that I think most people live their entire lives and never experience that, like, to the same level that that is at the UK Fruit Festival. It's really beautiful. It's so special. I'd hate for anybody to miss it, to be honest. If it doesn't sell out year-to-year, something's wrong in this world. Because it's the greatest opportunity to improve your life that you'll find. You'll never find a better opportunity.
That's brilliant, man. Thanks a lot for your endorsement there. I look forward to seeing you there again.
100%.
Anything else you want to talk about, just in closing? Any last comments or any last message? Anything you've been thinking about recently you want to get off your chest? Whatever you'd like to say to the world.
Wow.
Fruit Fest community, at least.
I'm the latest trend is that veganism is taking the world by storm. It was on the Dr. Oz show in the US. He was promoting it openly. Apparently he's been living that way for a while, but he's never really talked about it. But he was saying the word vegan over and over again during his show. When Dr. Oz is talking about veganism, you know that it's really getting out there.
Yeah.
The top of his list was fruits and vegetables. So not grains. And the 80-10-10 message is behind that. And with that wave of veganism, I really think that people are going to be more ready than ever to make the step to go raw vegan. The healthy way of eating raw vegan, of fresh food. And I'm super excited about that. And so it's an exciting time, and I encourage you to get involved in the movement, in the community, and watch it go where it's never been before. That's my thoughts. I just think it's all going to next level. Specifically, it's veganism at the moment. But on the back of that, raw veganism is the obvious next step. So.
Absolutely.
I think it's really cool.
Okay. Well, thanks a lot, Grant. If anyone's, I'll just check to see if there's any last minute questions for you. Yeah, a few people have just said that they had the same experience of the fish smell.
That's terrible. It's so bad. It's so unexpected. It just slaps you in the face. Sure. Oh my goodness.
Yeah. Okay, well,
but yeah.
I was just going to say thanks a lot, Grant, and have a good birthday and a good time out today with your family.
Thank you very much. Yep, much love to all.
Right.
I'm looking forward to a good day.
Yep, speak to you soon.
Thanks so much for the call. Thank you. See you at the festival.
Yep, absolutely. Okay, everyone. Well, I'll be here for a while just in case there's any further questions that people have that they want me to answer. So you've got any last minute questions about the festival, about anything that we're doing, about anything that's come up in the last few hours or in the last day. So I'll be here, but I'll probably take a quick break. Be back in a second, but you can still, if you're watching this on YouTube, you can still put some questions down below, and I'm happy to answer those questions. I'll just put down the email address at the festival as well, in case you've got want to contact us there. Or you can phone. Also, I'll put my number there. I'll be back in a second. And I'll just send out. Send out one email.
Hello. Mm. Drawing in the crowds.
Always, yeah. Yeah, I've got, there's still some people watching.
I know, it wasn't more than death.
No, it's probably just us. I'm just going to send out one last email. But...
Yeah.
record even this.
One we did yesterday, I don't know.
What's the deposit?
What's the deposit?
Is it different program?
The deposit is
the first payment. Divided by six.
Yeah, if it's the moment it's the first payment divided by six plus the remainder.
Plus the remainder?
Yeah, so it doesn't divide perfectly by six, so there's a remainder, so it might be like slightly more than the five payments essentially. So it balances out. And you've got to take 10% off or 5% off.
Good luck, Robbie. Hey, Robbie. One of them potatoes, really. Have you got that steamed veg on yet? What time is the engine coming?
What meant for that? I'd say we set up to Mickey D's or something.
Yeah.
Are you off?
Huh?
Are you actually off?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't know how I'm saying it all, but yeah. Since.
How long have you been here?
Well, I think I've been wrong since May.
Since May?
Yeah.
Where did you go to the when did you come back?
The last day in August. And then I got back like 2 weeks ago. Maybe not more than 2 weeks ago, like. 3 weeks ago, but yeah, 3 weeks ago.
Better out there over winter. Is it better out there over winter?
Oh man, yeah. No, I've been to Mexico, it's nice weather. I didn't want to come back, but kind of had to.
Really?
Yeah.
I thought you were free.
Yeah, I know, but I needed to. Do some things and rest of that, a bit of a bad news. I wanted to rest that and some money. And
what are you doing?
Just yeah?
What are you doing?
Yeah. Nothing yet.
Nothing.
So trying to find a job.
Looking for donations.
Yeah.
Get an old pen.
Yeah, and get coffee. Thanks for running. The fucking bag broke my the headline broke my bag.
Doesn't it?
So I'm trying to get a refund off of it.
Norwegian.
Okay, I think we're going to end the live stream. I don't think there's any questions coming up right now. I like the way you type.
Thank you.